A very good evening and welcome this edition of The Fourth Estate. The Fourth Estate happening at a time when every prediction, especially the media, went against went the other way. And it's not the first time, it is the second time, the British media heavily predicted that Britain would vote to remain in the European Union. Shock to everybody, they voted for Brexit. Now, the Donald Trump election, which I know has been debated over the last 1 week since the election, especially for Ugandans, since Wednesday. It has been top of the media, of social media searches and social media commentary on WhatsApp, on Facebook, on Twitter over the last few days. We'll be continuing to take a look at that, giving the media perspective. Let me just make one quick comment. There's a story that's been making lots of rounds on social media the whole of today, which is the unfortunate incident involving the death of a gentleman at the Forest Mall and an alleged shooter who says he is actually, he came in as a rescuer. That story will be learning more about it later, and you will be informed about where that story goes. Two people are in custody, in police custody, as police continues to investigate that incident which happened last night. Apparently, what we're hearing now is a small incident involving a scratching of a car in a parking lot at the Forest Mall that results into a shooting and a death of a community development officer from Aru County, I think. Let me introduce the guests in studio tonight. Timothy Nyakahuma Kaligira, his chief executive officer, publisher, and editor-in-chief at the Kampala Express, which is an online publication or a Facebook newspaper. Tim, very nice to have you.
Good evening, Desmos. As they just switch the other way around.
Mm-hmm. When they're on radio, they say good evening. Good evening.
I live alone.
Nicholas Sengova. Nicholas authors a weekly column in the Daily Monitor and social commentator. I should stop there. I have learned to stop. Nick, very nice to have you.
Thank you very much. Good evening, viewers.
Tim, let me start with you. The intriguing journey of Donald Trump. Why and how did pollsters and the media get it wrong?
Well, the reason they got it wrong was the same reason the Ugandan elite and many Western elite in the 1970s got what some of us who research Ugandan history now understand to be wrong. Idi Amin wrong. Idi Amin, you know, was like the way Donald Trump is. Cantankerous, chaotic, unpredictable, shoots his mouth off, that sort of person. So from the moment this crude, uncouth man appears in the midst and becomes a leader, and you just feel like throwing up at the very sight and thought of him. The minute the media got biased and felt, as I wrote in today's Monitor, the Sunday Monitor, that Democrats, liberals, conservatives, Republicans, independents, Green Party people, all aside, with the differences, you know, notwithstanding, share one thing in common: the consensus of America is this shining city on a hill. Mm-hmm. America is new Britain. America is new Europe. That's why you hear new Hampshire,
New England.
It was still European, but set off in a new land to recreate Europe, but without the feudal chains and whatnot. And in fact, in the early days, even if you see the architecture in Washington, the Congress, the buildings of the Supreme Court, the White House, you know, the colonnaded structures, you can see that attempt to reproduce old
Europe.
Roman, yes, the Roman, you know, the Roman temples and whatnot. So they saw themselves as a free, more reasonable, rational Europe. And for that, the elite of America tried to act like Europe's elite. You know, the Harvard University, the sports, the idea that golf, tennis are for the elite, and then baseball, basketball, and whatnot are for the ordinary people. So even the behavior of their leaders is that expectation that you must be of some refinement. You can't talk a certain way, you can't behave a certain way. So when Trump, with this kind of Marlowe-ish wealth, you know, glittering pillars and whatnot, comes in the midst, they just could not take him seriously, and then he begins acting the Trump that he is. You know, wife, former supermodel.
The Trump as in a TRA MP or
Trump as TRA MP, that, you know, this new money, but that lacks refinement. Mm. So they rejected Trump. The minute they rejected Trump emotionally and feeling this is just money, but out of our class. This is not
money without class.
Money without class, yes. Then they stopped being media and became basically social media commentators. The minute that switched, then they began looking for what they wanted to see. Every opinion poll that comes in, don't verify, latest polls, ABC, Washington Post, Trump doing bad. Yes, we know it's doing bad. They just became like twas with Idi Amin. Every rumor of so-and-so disappeared must be Amin. Body was found near the Nile must be Amin. So these exiles in Tanzania begin doing those things to discredit Amin. And the BBCs are all, everything's Amin. Remember the headlines. Trump comes and says, Hillary Clinton has done a deal with the devil. Headlines. People who understand English perfectly, who understand metaphors, begin. Trump calls Clinton a devil. Even in Uganda, we know to say you've done a deal with the devil is a figure of speech, meaning you have allied with, you know, unprincipled resources, but they take it literally. He calls a devil. What kind of man is this calls a devil? Then one day he says, Hillary Clinton, if you believe in gun control that much, let's take away the guns from your bodyguards and see what happens.
So he has called for her
to be assassinated. People. The American media has never lost credibility as they did this year. So from that point of view, when they got that petty, then from pollsters to everybody, they just lost track.
Let me just, same question to Nicholas. How did the media get it so wrong? Because every commentator, and I need to put a disclaimer on this, it's the media we largely consume here in Africa that we're using to assess. But if you see the replication across Europe, they tend to follow the same kind of analysis. CNN 24 hours, including even Fox News, I think apart from guys like Sean Hannity, who stood out, but everybody else seemed to get it wrong. How could that happen?
I think one of the team has put up a good explanation, but another very important thing is the kind of candidate that you had in Trump, and everybody is saying it over and over again. He has never held any office, any post in government. He was not in the military. Basically, he was not any of those people they call the group from Washington. He was actually an outsider, a newcomer, you know. So when you have that sort of person, you know, when you're writing news about people, there are certain things that you know, and then you start building and coming up with judgment. You know, on abortion, he stands here. On this, but this is a person who has not held any of those offices. So what do you do? Where do you start from? So your judgment,
even defining what he stands
what
for.
He stands for. Yes. So your judgment is, unless you are really extremely, unless you are extremely keen, and it will have an effect on the way you judge him. You know, and so in the case of Trump. You know, it's like you're starting to build a database, a fresh one, in as far as his political journey is concerned. There are all these other colorful things they knew: how he made money, how he lost it, how he, you know, his attitude towards women and all that. But to assess him now, as you assess a politician, it was always going to be very, very difficult. You know, and let me just say this also, that even for many of us who are not really part of this election but observing from the outside, it was very difficult. Maybe the teams, maybe, but for many of us, there's no way. I just looked at it and I said, now this one. And since we are used to this political correctness, you know, you don't, if you're looking for votes, you don't annoy people by, you know, dismissing them as rapists, you know. And then here comes somebody, you know, he says, those are rapists, they are thieves, they are criminals. I say, but these are potentially your voters, you know. I'll deport them, I'll do this. So whenever I listened to Trump, I was, you know, there's no way. I was very puzzled. It was very difficult to make any judgment. So I really, I feel for the media on the issue of getting this matter wrong. I really feel for them, you know. There's no way, you know. I really, because there's no way, you know. You need some ground from where to begin.
One of the major arguments was Trump did not have a path to victory. That's the line that was most commonly used. So if you looked at all the models that were being presented, Wolf Blitzer on CNN, John King, the gurus of analysis, including on MSNBC, including on CBS, including Fox, they would show you that he has no path to victory.
Precisely.
The question someone would ask, did the media analysis, because it shaped the debate around Trump, forget something important about the demographic? Because you can choose to annoy people if you know you don't want them to be your voter. If you know you have a core section of the voters. How come that voice never came out?
That's just why it's very difficult to rationally explain Trump, because how many people would want to annoy people whose votes you just might need? He's just one of these fortunate people, like, you know, these 110 meters hurdles runners. As soon as the gun goes off, you start firing across the hurdles. You know, 12 of them like collapse along the way, but basically you finish. You're not penalized for hitting those hurdles. So in your work, there are all these hurdles, but then you get a gold medal. Can I say Trump foretold this reaction? Did he understand? He was just being crazy. And I think it's just one of those examples where if there's anything we must learn, is sometimes just be yourself. Just be yourself, because, like I said,
Can we conclude at this stage and say Trump was being himself?
He was being himself, but it's a very strange year, because please remember, you've just mentioned the US election, the biggest shock of the year. Then there was, of course, the Brexit vote. But remember, there was the one that started last year in the world of sports, Leicester City FC. Tell me of those three which anyone saw. Who could have foreseen Leicester City? You can say one or two, let's say, you know,
1 to 5,000.
Yes, 1 to 5,000, exactly. So 2016 has just become the year we look back on and say people...
As late as Tuesday, predictions were Hillary Clinton, the most conservative, said 90% chance to victory. Others, the more excited, gave her 98% chance of winning the presidency. I mean, in the world of analysis, in the world of models, in the world of all this research, how does that happen? What are you going to rely on? The media and pollsters, which is the second question I wanted to put, got it completely wrong on Brexit. Like Timothy reminds us, Leicester City, the Premier League, a lot of Ugandans watch the Premier League, 1 to 5,000 odds for Leicester City to win. In this world of so much information, in this world of so much ease of communication, how does that happen?
No, but there are two things about the pollsters. First of all, it is not exactly accurate to say that they got it wrong. Hillary won the popular vote.
Yes.
So actually, people said they would. Whoever did that said they would vote for her, and she got the votes. You know, because the U.S. Arrangement is different. The issue of the electoral colleges, that one you know now, you know. She won the popular vote. So they didn't exactly get it wrong, you know. It's not, that is not absolute. So they got it right. But to answer your question, we must start at this other point. No, we, in this election, we did not get all the information, you know. Now flies on the wall are beginning to come out, you know. You know, now, and you know, as JF Kennedy loved to say, to quote, you know, success has 100 fathers, failure is another one. There are people who are beginning to bring out information about certain things that were happening in Hillary's camp and in with the media and so on. For instance, I was listening to BBC radio. There was a lady there talking about pollsters and all that. Now, it appears there were some of them were quite, were based on manipulation, you know. The questions, the problem with polls is that people don't actually tell you what questions were asked. The questions were not clear cut. Will you vote for Trump or Hillary? No. Some of the questions were, because she gave an example, she said some of them were, which of the two candidates do you think is more experienced? Hillary? Or Trump? To drive this country forward, Hillary or Trump? Of course, Hillary would score on that one. Then the other question would be, who do you think, will you vote for change or for experience? And there it would come out, it was not very clear cut. But the other one, which was clear cut, is what they would put forward. Our people have said, you know, it was not a direct question, will you vote for Trump or Hillary? A yes, no question, no. Experience or who has more experience? So that one they would put forward, you know. So that was also another problem. But finally, towards the end, still flies on the wall are bringing it out that, you know, there was panic along there, especially after that, which I think was an unfortunate incident. The letter from the FBI, you know, saying we are investigating, and you know, there was in the Hillary camp, it staggered their momentum, and towards the end, there was a lot of misinformation. Actually, those 98% and all those things, there was now misinformation. It was a desperate attempt, you know,
to counter. I also think personally, would share my opinion. I think Hillary and her camp made a huge mistake not to capitalize on the FBI chief's second comment to say, I mean, clearing her in those last 2 days. The attempt to say that is too toxic to touch, just leave it alone, let's not even go there.
No, but you see,
I think significantly worse.
The problem is that, you know, it came very late, and what was happening on the ground, you know, there was not that Hillary and company were unpopular. But they could actually see the momentum on the other side, on Trump's side, and that can be very, very. It can stress you and wear you down, you know. So you could sense that frustration. You know?
Okay, gentlemen, we'll need to take a quick commercial break, and when we return, we'll have expanded the panel here. A regular panelist, Onapito Ekwamoloi, will be joining us. I will be right back. You're still watching The Fourth Estate, and we've now been joined by Onapito Ekwamoloi. Ona, what was happening? You're organizing the victory party, or the biggest news coming out of Trump Towers today is there are two names being suggested for his potential chief of staff. One of them is a guy who runs a media company, and they're thinking that might actually tell the choice of chief of staff will tell what direction Trump takes his presidency. And the other bigger story, I think, especially for many people around this continent, is his decision to include 4 family members on his transition team. 2 sons, a daughter, and a son-in-law. He's put them on his transition team. And you can predict fairly that maybe at least two of them will end up serving very closely in his cabinet. But, Ona, how did the media, pollsters, get it so wrong? Let me put a disclaimer. Nicholas here told us they didn't get it so wrong because Hillary finally won the popular vote, but she's not president. And the prediction was Hillary was just the shoo-in president.
Look, Charles, as one would say, an American trained journalist, I'm certainly, I believe, I'm a strong believer in the American media and their strengths, their historical place in the history of journalism, starting especially with Watergate, you know, how much they have turned around the world.
Right.
But I think on dispatch location, it's really a classic case of the monkey exposing its, other parts, the higher it goes. Because the media, to me, it's not so much the outcome, which is where the media really, really lost it. It's the process, you know? Even if Hillary had won, the media, I think, generally would have been seen to have lost it in terms of one of the cardinal principles of journalism, which is fairness. And the American concept of fairness is essentially about giving both sides. They never want to run a story where by one side is seen not to have had its say and had its say fairly. So it was clear from the outset that the way you followed it was Trump had no chance. Not because he had no chance, but the media said he had no chance. From the word go, his announcement is fake, he's going to collapse. Throughout the primary season, it's just a matter of time, he's going to collapse. Even as he was heading towards the primary victory, they said it can't happen, it will be a contested convention, somebody's going to stop him. There was, and then when he started with Hillary, that is the end of it. It was just a small band of radicals in the Republican Party who are supporting him. His percentage has never gone beyond 40%. The narrative was so clear cut. Trump had no chance. And not because the Americans, as we have all seen now, said he had no chance. The media said he had no chance. So it was absolute media bias. I don't think they didn't get it right. They just wanted to believe themselves and the public. And this is not the exception, the American media. I think even here, sometimes we as the Kampala, largely Kampala-based media, we get carried away by our own analysis of things. And you can say the Ugandan election is not an equivalent, but perhaps there are quite a number of occasions when we think Museveni is going this time because the mood in Kampala feels so, and we tell ourselves so. But if you go to the countryside, sometimes it's different, sometimes it's not. So I think the media
led itself down. In defense of your Ugandan journalist, that the American election, and I think the United Kingdom referendum on whether or not to stay in the European Union, are the only two elections where everybody went in without knowing. Both Trump didn't know that he would emerge victorious.
No, you can't know.
Yes, at Trump Tower, they learned the next morning, when the results started coming in the night, that they were also as surprised. Fox refused to call the election. Actually, CNN called the election before Fox could, and Fox is the Republican-leaning media. It failed to call the election. Hillary did not expect, of course, to lose the election. No. So she went knowing, I'm going to win this election. No one predicted the result.
Absolutely.
And for me, I think in Uganda you can fairly predict.
I know you can. So for me, first of all,
Hillary's headquarters, the confetti machines were ready. You have what Newsweek.
But really, I know now that it has happened, it's of course easy for everyone to say, I told you Trump would win. Honestly, I sort of believed, I wanted also to tell myself that it would win, partly because over time I've become cynical about conventional wisdom. All the time you see people posturing and saying, you know, me and Tim, you know, as well, we are being called racist in some respect. Because there are things people want to take for granted, they want you to flow with the wave, and they don't want you to speak outside the box, you don't fit. And it's so hard to support something that doesn't fit. But I think for me, the telltale sign was the online polls. In the primaries, after every debate, the mainstream media would declare Trump was finished for once. He has been beaten by Cruz, beaten by the lady. But the online polls would give him a landslide. And that's what came out in the final outcome. Even in the main contest with Hillary, the online polls always gave him a landslide, but the mainstream media and CNN and his polls, they'll say he has been defeated 3 times. So I used to say, look, there's something in these online polls. They call them voodoo polls, and again, the mainstream media say they are voodoo polls, they are not
for obvious reasons.
You know? But in the end, there was actually telltale signs that Trump was having a silent vote. And I think it goes for the same for what we think is accepted, everyone must go with it. There are very few who are willing to stand up against it, but there is always this so-called silent majority.
Timothy, one of the major things analysis has avoided, one, yes, is what Ona is talking about, which is which was presented to the world as voodoo polls. And Trump would always tweet and say, these opinion polls are saying we're going to win, but no one paid attention to them. One of the major things that the media analysis has ignored is how would you explain the fact that especially the Democrats or the liberal thinking section of American society tends to pay so much attention to the actual minorities? I mean, blacks in the United States are 12% of the population. Latinos are about how many now? The Latino vote? But between them, they're about 28% of the total American population. 72% of the American population is still
Muslims are 1%.
Yes, is still white. So why was there this obsession with appealing to a minority to swing an election?
Well, that's the part I just failed to understand. And that's the arrogance, sorry to say that, that's been developing since the first Clinton term in 1992 among these liberals, the Democrats. You know the way the liberals are, there's just, like Andrew Mwenda said on KFM on Friday, and I think has written for The Independent, this arrogance, this patronizing arrogance, this missionary sense. You can imagine when Clinton takes office the first time, it's over the gaze, it's don't ask, don't tell. Then later, even when Obama is running the first time, they ask him about the marriage, and he says, as a Christian, I believe marriage should be for, you know, man and woman. Then the second term in 2012, out of the blue, he now thinks it's okay to have gay marriage. So even Americans...
No, actually, he was also jacked into that because...
Yes, but by Joe Biden, the vice president. Just spoke, is another Trump.
Yes.
Just spoke, and then Clinton, like Obama
spoke
was forced...
Script.
Yes, and then Obama was forced... So Americans, for all this liberal talk, only in the last 4 years have they come to embrace gay marriage to this extent. Now you're expecting countries like Uganda, where 97% of the population is opposed to gay marriage. You know Uganda, socially, we're so many decades.
Where did you get that figure from? 97%?
Who
did that research?
Well, no, there are these opinions. Don't remember the time of the gay bill, 2009, 2010, when they said, some would say 97%, some would say 90, but it was a very high percentage. But you can, even if I just squared the poll in my head, it would still make sense. 90, a very high percentage. I listened to all the radio stations all across. You remember the president, the NRM meeting in Tebe? You know, people, there's a foreign policy implication to this. Hillary Clinton called me, wanted to talk about what gays? Stephen Harper of Canada talk about what gays? That sort of thing. So this crusading side in which what is ours must be yours. What I think is right is yours. That constant step on people and this obsession with not only the minorities, but the oddities. You know this narration in American history that loves the cowboy movies, the underdog, the anti-hero. In the Sylvester Stallone, the Rocky movies, that sense of the guy who no one took seriously that wins has become an obsession. American movies, novels, short stories, TV scripts, and whatnot. So, yes, to think about it, why are you so obsessed with the minority and ignore the majority? Same thing like when President Obama goes to Kenya for his first official visit. Gets there, what is he first talking about? Predicting the first things, yeah, gays, these people have rights. Until President Kenyatta says, excuse me.
That's not our problem.
We have so many problems here, Al-Shabaab. What's all this obsession with gays and Uhuru Kenyatta tells him of? That narrowing down to obsession, I think Nick has explained very well. I hope he brings it up. We've discussed it on phone sometimes. That absorption and fascination with the mystery of the perversion, that cult-like obsession with perversion, with rites of ritual, you know, with this sense of there's a mystery, there's some fashionableness about being gay and whatnot. The Democrats swallowed, went further and further down and forgot mainstream America is still 70% Christian, is mostly white. And so they narrowed themselves down to that and they could not see why Trump is telling off all these minorities. And they are minorities for a reason, because they have a small percent of the population.
And just before it comes in, and then they sort of, the media decided to criminalize the alternative to what Tim has been describing. And they actually did not help Clinton in that process. They made supporting Clinton a stigma. I mean supporting Trump.
Yes.
So it was so negative and people basically went underground.
Yes.
You couldn't come on a show and you want to get some money as a pundit from foundations and what and say you support Trump.
Yeah.
So you basically you'd be finished.
Very misleading.
Exactly. That's what I
think. Nick, since the election on for us here, we were beginning to receive those results on Wednesday morning.
Yeah.
The that was night in America. There have been all these protests across the country, across the United States. In Oregon, someone was shot yesterday. I think someone in Portland, Oregon was shot yesterday. Protests in front of Trump Tower in New York have been consistent since Monday and across the country. Will a Trump presidency succeed? And there's one professor who predicted that Trump would win, but he's also predicted that Trump will be impeached. So will a Trump presidency succeed?
That is a very, very difficult one to tell, just like it is extremely, it was extremely difficult for me to tell that Trump would win. There are a few things that you should note. One, this election the depended so much, the outcome, on the character of the man, Trump, not the Republicans and what they believe in, and you know. Because, you see, whenever Trump, there were some changes in his team. Whenever there were changes, he would tone down a bit. Then he would become the Trump that we know. You know, I'll arrest him, I'll deport them, I'll, you know, that sort of. So,
during the debate, if I were president, you'd be in jail.
You'd be in jail. So the question is, will Trump then, when he gets to Washington, finally become conformist? Will he become sensitive towards what basically makes a successful American politician, you know? will he come to? And there are certain things that you can see Trump does not seem to appreciate reality, you know? Some of these things like aid actually don't help us who receive it. They actually help the American economy, you know? If they're bringing you, say, a package of $7 billion, you know, the cars, the computers, that will all come for America. The salaries go back, you know? So will he appreciate these things? Will he become, you know, conformist? Will he be gracious? Will he reach out? You know? So it is extremely, Trump is such an unknown. It is so difficult for you to tell.
You'd say.
So, but you can now have two scenarios and say, if, you know, he comes on that side. First of all, most important, will he carry out most of the promises that he made, you know, to make America great again, you know?
Mm-hmm.
There are people who believe, the people who have lost jobs, you know, believe that actually if you push out immigrants, because one of the issue with immigrants, whether it's in Europe or America, is that if you have, say, an engineer who has come from Mexico, is trained, like an engineer in the States, he's willing to take, you know, maybe half the pay that an American can take for the job, you know? So if he goes away, do we get back to that level where we were getting jobs? And so does he, will Trump actually go and live up to this? Will he live up to these promises that actually made people believe that there can be change, you know? Mm. Those are very important things. If he does that, it will be a... But if he goes and he keeps fighting, and he has begun on that very note, you know, the other day when he was in the White House, he ignored the press, and it has never happened.
Though his first major interview, the CBS 60 Minutes,
yeah.
One, he said he would keep some aspects of Obamacare,
yeah,
which was one of the biggest drivers of his numbers.
Yeah,
he said there are some things that are good, and he said that he got after meeting with President Obama.
Yeah.
He also said...
A deal maker.
Yes. He's toned down on Hillary Clinton and says she's a great woman.
Because she's finished a great fighter.
Charles, I think to your question, first of all, to the professor who predicted. Remember, the professor had to qualify his prediction.
Mm.
And I think even that predicting that he'll be impeached was part of the qualifying.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
he was trying to be conventional, yes, or contrarian, but within
the conventional. The initial candidates, yes, have been predicting for 30 years, but if he loses, it won't. So he was also under a lot of pressure. They were saying he was also a voodoo professor. He teaches in my former university, American University.
Mm.
They are trying to run him down as well, but he really had to cling to his... right prediction.
The
Ugandan MP, if he had lost, I think he would just lose his teaching job. But just hold on. Will Trump succeed? He will not succeed the way we know an American president to succeed, because the media will not allow him.
Mm.
At least the perception of him succeeding will never. Mm. From day one, he has failed. You just need to read the Washington Post, the New York Times.
Mm.
They are going to have their narrative.
New York Times has apologized, doesn't it?
Mm. But like, the backlash from them is going to be consistent. They will have to make sure he will be the most wretched president in terms of them.
Mm.
But of course, if he does the right things, he will again win re-election despite having failed in courts.
Mm.
So will he be impeached according to the professor? I think the Republicans were really desperate for a messiah. In fact, the narrative was that the Republican Party would be in a total turmoil by today.
Mm.
But somehow, the miracle of Trump has saved them. I don't think they would be so stupid after almost losing all hope about the White House.
Mm-hmm.
The liberal culture was seen to be so entrenched that the Republicans needed to make a 360 shift if they were to win the White House again.
Okay.
And here comes a Republican...
let me just add this.
You could save them.
And let me just add this from what you said about being desperate. Mm. You could tell over the years that liberal tendencies had started, had infected and affected, you know, the conservatives.
Okay.
Everybody was shifting slightly.
Even if I might have made comments before the election, which suggested like, I might also have supported Clinton. I was indifferent about the election. Mm. The only thing that kept me asking questions was, can the American society, the American voters, keep the same party in the White House beyond two terms? Because that's kind of an almost established tradition now. You serve a maximum of two terms, get out of power. So
it was actually the Republicans, I think.
Yes, who have
Bush and Reagan.
Yes, who succeeded in getting that extension, but for only a short time. Just before we take the break, Timothy, Do you see Trump running one term?
But Trump, if you notice, Trump is sort of like, if Bush, George W. Bush is 40%, Trump is like 75%. You know, that sense of clumsiness, clueless, unserious is the image we had of George Bush, who opinion polls and conventional wisdom says fluked the way to the presidency. Mm. But as you know, America, 9/11, September 11th, the terrorist attacks, now became the beginning of the Bush presidency. So from this whining of, this man cheated his way, should have been Al Gore, 9/11 now created this Donald Rumsfeld, you know, war on terror side. Trump's luck is such that he's just going to do so well. Like, first of all, he got 4% of the black vote, where opinion polls had thought he'd get like 2%.
He got 8%.
8%, sorry, yes. Where they had thought he'd get 2%. Mm. He got 37% or 34%. Over the college-educated white.
Oh, college-educated white.
He did 53%. He got basically, I think, more women voted for Trump overall than voted for Hillary Clinton. Really.
You don't like to hear what there was a comment on BBC talking about the women and his sex issues. As one woman, the journalist had to confront her about Trump's abuses, alleged abuses. The woman said, he can come and grab me. Let's take a quick commercial break. We'll be right back.
I said that on Twitter. I got attacked. Yeah.
Clothes and clothes love Nomi.
When you trust something with your eyes closed, it's got to be good for you. At Fresh Dairy, we spare no effort to bring you the purest milk. It's fresh and tasty so that you keep enjoying the good things in life. Fresh Dairy, simply good for you.
Are you sure it's going to work?
Yeah.
When someone steals power, everyone else suffers. Wuyo, report power theft on 0312-360-777 or simply visit wuyo.umeme.ug. Umeme, powering Uganda.
They say you only live once. We say, if you do it right, once is enough. With the Standard Chartered Safari Savings, so whether you have countless dreams for her, endless adventures to explore, or lasting memories to make, you have one life. Make it count with our Safari Savings. Also, enjoy additional benefits. To find out more, call 031-329-4100 or visit sc.com/UG. Here for good, Standard Chartered Bank.
Tomorrow night. Brought to you by
Can Bebe Diaper, your smart choice for a happy family.
Tomorrow night, a captivating story of love and betrayal, where love knows no boundaries and limits. Ambition is the driving force that wreaks havoc in lives of a close-knit family. Tomorrow night.
Can baby diapers have a dry fill system which absorbs the liquidity instantly, prevents leakage, and keeps the baby dry and comfortable? Available in all leading stores countrywide.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back to this last segment of the Fourth Estate. Charles Martins Juko, watching us all the way from Nigeria. Thank you very much for the support. Charles was having trouble getting his internet connection to watch the show. He watches all the time and says he's managed to get his way around it. So thank you very much, Charles. Nteja Sima is saying, just like Rubaga South got a raw deal in Katolo Buama, the American people lost it the day they voted for Donald Trump. The riots are telling it all. That's the question we need to be answering next. Andrew Karamaji is saying, just one question. Why are we all the wiser now? How come we didn't predict the win, but are now able to analyze the results, why they look the way they did? And Jose Nwabine, I think Jose Nwabine, somewhere in Kabola, Liantonde, is saying, just I'm trying to get your message. Let me check so I can get your message and read it out. Yes. He says, guys, I strongly believe that most institutions, including the media in America, are being controlled by the gays or their sympathizers, majority of who must have been on Clinton's side. So it shouldn't be a surprise that the media deliberately demonized Trump while marketing Clinton. Well, those are some of the opinions that are coming through. Let me ask, how does it matter that Trump is going to be the president of the United States effective 21st January 2017? Starting with you, for Africa, does it matter?
Well, what matters is the fact that Hillary Clinton did not win. Because we've been pushed into this dichotomy of everything's just race and identity, so most blacks around the world, including Africa, have an instinctive feeling of not to trust the Republicans. There's just this feeling of he abuses blacks, doesn't like blacks, so support Hillary Clinton. But there's another sub-story, the much bigger one, which is, of course, over the question of homosexuality. Mm. And you know how many African countries have resisted that. So had Clinton won this election, this momentum that had been building up, this putting us under pressure, Uganda passes this anti-homosexual bill, Sweden, Norway, I don't know, the World Bank and whatnot, cut aid. That confidence the Democrats had been developing, we've now reached like a peak capacity. Basically, we reached a stage where even in Washington, they would wonder why, you know, primary schools in Uganda are not teaching about gays and all this, would have been choked under these liberals. At least Uganda, and as I say, most of Africa is opposed to that. So the first thing is that basically the foot that's been put on our necks is going to be taken off. Trump is going to be indifferent to that matter. In other words, ironically, the best thing to happen to Africa from that point of view is a Trump presidency. In other wider things like the counterinsurgency operations in Somalia, Central African Republic, South Sudan, some of these are the civil service side of the U.S. government. Those will continue. You said, you know, money for drugs, education, judiciary, that, you know, the aid side of these things, that continues. Will Trump come to Africa? I very much wonder. I don't know if it matters, but it's going to be that. So Africa's main experience under Trump is going to be a significant easing of pressure on we, the so-called homophobes of Africa. Mm. And that, for Africa, is going to be, I think, the greatest of differences.
Okay. Nick, with Trump in the White House or not, does it matter? How does it matter to the African continent?
I think, you know, from my experience, what we've seen, what we've read over the years, it's about American interests mainly. All these other, they can tweak it here and there, but the question is, where is America in all of this? Now, for me, I would mainly look at the issue of the growth of the influence of China in Africa, you know, and the East, China, Russia, you know, and some of these other countries, India. If you're going to make America great again, you will still need cheap resources, cheap oil, you know, and many of the things, the raw materials that you have from Africa. So from that economic point of view, you still have the engagement from the U.S. But this other business of Trump the madman coming to kick out, I don't know which dictator, no, forget about it, you know.
I've been listening to some radio stations here, and many of the people would call in, you know, I'm so-and-so from Kitintale, you know, I like Trump because he said he's going to set out, you know, so-and-so who we have failed. No, it doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. You know, it doesn't. In fact, you know, we had a very embarrassing, no, I'm saying that is very difficult. We had a very embarrassing incident. I think there was a press conference somewhere, and the journalist actually asked the yes. president about
during the campaign.
Funny thing that came from the internet, social media. In Kenya, that yeah. Trump said that you know he.
And the president responded. I've been reviewing his clip. The clip of him speaking to Mr. Trump to what about America?
But the truth is that I really think that when Trump gets in the White House and he has started working. There are realities that are going to come to him that you cannot have. America cannot step out if it wants to grow at home. It's not possible. So you'll still have those engagements, and I believe he's likely. You won't have this political correctness of, you know, we only want to deal with Democrats and all those, you know, clean people. They'll come, and the way America was dealing with people like the Mobutu Sese Sekos, it will be about, you know, what is in the continent for us. Mm. And Africa has the resources. Africa has that side to it. So we shall still feature very, feature greatly there. And I think he will not be so much involved in the political side of it. I don't see that side.
You've been closest to the powers, the corridors of power, than the rest of us here. As a former member of parliament, as someone who worked in State House, and now you're in the private sector. Trump is a businessman.
That's what he's they call the establishment, which has lost, so I don't want to be on that side.
in terms of policy, how much can an individual, especially the President of the United States, impact?
Not so much in this era, but first of all, I think we must give it to the Americans. There has been a lot of debate as to whether China is overtaking the U.S. and all this. I think this election once more underscores that the U.S. remains, across the world, including China, this is the subject of debate.
Mm.
When has anybody ever debated the outcome of the Chinese election by any stretch? So the fact that you can occupy the global mind,
the one of China.
This is modern version of true imperial control of the world, if you want, called by the Americans, whereby you occupy the mind of the young, the old, the women, the men of the world, talking about yourselves, which is perfect, which is great for them, and you must give it to them. So does it really matter who is the president of the U.S.? I definitely don't think it does. I think there are systems are so entrenched in terms of control and checks and balances that the president is really a figurehead.
Mm.
And I think one of the reasons why the Americans chose Trump is that he fits that figurehead in terms of providing relief, comic relief, and excitement. Remember, the American economy and many Western economies, the government role is so minimal.
Mm-hmm.
Most people live without government, so to say. Mm. And people are bored. They are in their gadgets, and Trump at least gives them the excitement.
Mm.
And I think one of the reasons he won was just that human desire for something mysterious, something exciting, and curiosity. It's almost like a movie. Mm. You have a bad character, but somehow you want to see his next move. So most people want to see this story. We are all
so
curious,
well.
What will the Trump presidency be?
Mm.
And
well, two things. Two things that are a fact. One, Trump was made by TV when he ran that show, The Apprentice, for quite a bit of time. Two is 16 years ago, a cartoon character called The Simpsons predicted that Trump would become president because it was modeled on Trump. And then another thing is for a guy who ran a campaign targeting immigrants. He's been married 3 times, and I think all his wives have been immigrants.
Two of them
have been immigrants.
Ivanka and Melania
now. Melania migrated to the United States only in 2000. She married Trump in 2005, became an American citizen in 2006. 10 years later, she's First Lady of the United States of America. And What else explains the American dream?
He knows the power of the immigrants from close quarters.
No, she just didn't get married. She got married to a billionaire. But we have some callers online, so please indulge me. Let me take one or two callers. Hello? Kindly turn off your TV.
Hello?
Turn down the volume on the TV set. Yes. Hello. Good evening and welcome to the Fourth Estate.
Yes, good evening too. My name is Edward.
Yes, Edward, go ahead with your question or comment.
Yes, now for me, for us Christians, we see Trump as Trump's win as the spiritual win because, first of all, he was always followed by evangelicals and pastors.
Mm.
Secondly, he's a person who was opposing gay marriages.
Mm-hmm.
Thirdly, he's against abortion. So, for us, that is a success. Then, secondly, the news anchor Carla Gorani on CNN interviewed a part of the electorate in Colorado, and most of the electorate could not trust the media. So I just wanted to notify you on this. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Edward. Edward, maybe just one question for you guys to respond to. Edward, I don't know, is Trump a Christian?
It's hard to know. Okay, well,
what are Trump's religious beliefs?
Hillary Clinton is a Methodist. He's a Protestant Methodist. Methodists are halfway between Presbyterians and Baptists. Trump is an Anglican. Trump is Trump is a German. His mother is Scottish. But in his religion, he's in Uganda we call Church of Uganda. He's an Anglican. Mm. He's an Episcopalian. Mm. That's his religion. But of course, like all things.
But I think when people talk about him being a Christian, They're talking about born-again, conservative,
typical Reagan, lip service, the Obama type. Whitney Houston was born again Christian. Everything in my name.
But he hangs with the right crowd in terms of the evangelical.
But it's not what you'd call, like the way Jimmy Carter was, like Malokole or George Bush, Jimmy Carter.
Mm.
That born again before I go to do anything, I pray. No, you remember Reagan and Nancy Reagan, superstition and whatnot. That type, panda, posture, Obama type.
Which is a thing that surprises me because religion, which is such an integral part of American politics, didn't come into play in this election between Trump and
because of what Ona has been emphasizing, the media. The media sets the agenda. Now, if you had brought religion up front, there would be problems for the Democrats, like Edward was talking about,
Yeah.
The issues of gay marriage would come up and all those things. It would be
intricate for her as well. It's an area where I think Hillary and Trump are square. I think are around the same level. You never hear invocation in this election of God bless the United States of America, which was so predominant in the race between Barack Obama and
John McCain. John McCain?
Mitt Romney, who was a Mormon. Let's take another caller. Hello? Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Yes, sir. Your name and where you're calling from?
Ashaka, calling from Abibi,
Karamoja. Hey, RDC Ashaka?
Yes, sir.
Yes, your question or comment, please.
Yes, good evening.
Good evening. Mm-hmm.
Mm. What does the winning of Trump mean for Africa and Uganda?
Okay. We just tried to answer that, but I'll have Ona have a go at it again.
All these lousy papers like New York Times and the other lousy ones like USA Today and the Chicago Tribune predicted, but some of us amateurs, they predicted right.
Yes.
If you go through my
you
Twitter
and Sean Hannity.
Exactly. And the reason was that in my case, okay, now I'm just pretending, but anyway, in my case, I went through the Google traffic because I'm very interested in the internet and data and metadata and cloud computing and all that social media. I was trying to answer one question in an era of mass data, metadata, the Edward Snowden type, where millions of emails and posts and tweets and forwards and shares and links can be sucked up, like in one touch of a button, you have all this data on Facebook, WhatsApp, and Instagram. should we still, one, rely on the traditional 1,800, 2,500 sample of 330 million people?
For the traditional opinion polls.
Or isn't this metadata, the one that flows through Facebook and WhatsApp continuously throughout the day, a better indication? And then all the data gets in, continuously Trump was always up in the Google News rank that's automatically generated by the computers. Trump was typically always up 98% of the time. He was always up against Hillary Clinton. We go and check, let's say, the traffic. I'm not talking about the nominal page likes on Facebook, but the actual 24-hour cycle
tracking.
Trump always had more traffic than
Clinton.
I don't know why I want to say Whitney Houston. When it came to even the news channels themselves, number one, in the world, by the way, in fact, on a Peter's point comes America's dominance, the most followed, most engaged, the most visited Facebook news page in the world, not just in America, in the world, is Fox News that you're all dismissing. After Fox News, I think it's Huffington Post, and then there's one other thing, BBC is about number 8, Al Jazeera number 40, that sort of thing. So all the tracking seemed to me to show this is a Republican story developing. I don't know if it will work for Trump, but this seems to be Republican. Fox News, number one, Trump in those opinion polls, I mean, in the tracking of the data, and as Onapito said, the online polls at the debates show he was winning. In fact, I almost think that Trump's allegation that Clinton won this popular vote by these illegal immigrants being smuggled into vote could be true. that difference, Trump should have won. Okay, I'm just being a conspiracy theorist.
Just give us your comment, because it's going to answer what it means.
No, I just wanted to say, just on that issue of the media, if you put together the people who follow Trump on social media, you have about 28 million people, Okay, some of them include people like Tim, in Uganda who may, So, traditional media, in this particular election, just like before, but in this one, mainly in this one, the issue of the influence of traditional media as opposed to, juxtaposed to social media, is a very, very important and valid one that whoever wants to stand for an election in America in future should think about, If the New York the New York Times pushes out its paper, still Trump, by just having that gadget, reaches out to really very, very many more people than that,
Yeah, but what does it mean?
Quickly,
the media, and then what does it mean?
The polls also became victims of the media, because there were some polls which were so consistent for Trump, but they were really hammered. And forget about the online polls. There was a tracking poll by
Rasmussen,
and then LA University.
Los Angeles Times, and I think University of Yes.
Real Clear didn't come up. That Real Clear Politics.
The LA Times.
They were also pushed below the radar by the coverage that they are not traditional. They are not. So that is one of the. So we could not see the story of Trump victory coming up. Again, for Africa, I think everyone has said, one, I think Africa will be relatively ignored, which is good, because I think Africans also want to be patronized. They don't want to do their own things. And maybe there will be some contagion effect. This belief that the underdog can win. Actually, some guy in Russia said, much as he's an opposition person, that much as Trump is seen to be a Putin ally, the opposition in Russia is also going to get some momentum out of this, that you can actually defeat the establishment, you can defeat the system. Many African opposition and their supporters are, of course, they are so beaten, I'm sure Uganda inclusive. So maybe this kind of happening historically sometimes helps spark other revolutions across the world.
And
people get
believed
that you can actually defeat the system.
Speaking of sparking other revolutions, Jean-Marie Le Pen, Marie Le Pen, that extremist,
the leader of the Front National,
Front National of
is going to be a good word.
thinks that she's going to her party is going to get a boost in France because of the Trump win and because of Brexit. But Angela Merkel in Germany. In the United Kingdom, they're struggling to find a way how to fit with a Trump presidency. China is also struggling to find out how it fits.
Charles, before we go, it's very, very important that we've talked about polls and all those things, but now what about the message of the man?
The message of the man.
Yes.
Can we come to that in just 1 minute? Let me just check if we have one caller.
We had no message.
Yes, let me pick one last caller and we get out of here. And then we'll come to the message of the man and the global political relation. Hello? Hello? Yes.
This is John Mary.
Yes, John Mary, where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Kawanda.
From Kawanda. Yes, keep your question or comment brief.
I think we are very happy about the meaning of this election.
Mm.
Because it has made, I think, that wave of the Hillary Clinton being the first lady winning would give the mystery to Africans. Where they will choose their way to come to president.
Mm.
I think that was very, very good for everyone.
Thank you, John Mary, for your comment. Let's just pick one more. Do we have there are many people trying to get through.
Yes.
Yes. Hello.
This is Edward again.
Yes, Edward.
We're discussing Trump again.
Yes.
Because, first of all, there was no real campaign on the side of Democrats. Apart from attacking Trump as a sexist and a racist. Then, secondly, you know, he won the Republican election. And he, you know, he against the Bush family. So I think Trump is a person who is going to lead America for even 2 terms.
Okay. Thank you, Edward. Yeah, let's come back to your issue.
I was saying the important Ona has dismissed. There was no message, but I'm talking about what Trump said he stood for. You know what people call racist and so on and so forth. But you see, America has suffered so much. You know, the U.S. has suffered so much in terms of people not having jobs. So when you come with that sort of message, what many of us who follow conventional wisdom look at as racist, for some of these people, they looked at Trump like you know, we have here in our traditional setting. If you have a rich man in the village who controls, you know, a vast piece of land, but he's mean, he's... When he has a tragedy, he has lost somebody. People buy alcohol for someone to, you know, to come out at night in the funeral and then speak. Trump spoke like that sort of...
The drunkard at the barrier,
you know. You have lost your child, but you're a very mean man, but we've forgiven, you know. So Trump is a sort of, we believe in America now. Mm. The people who believe in conventionalism, that is racism.
Mm-hmm.
But he's actually speaking for some people. So quietly, those are the people who went out and, you know.
He mobilized. Yeah. If you could say of the post-election interviews,
yes.
Mm. Where people were a little bit freer to say what, say their minds.
Yeah.
They interviewed a friend, I think, either in Texas or Nevada, I don't remember. Mm. They found guys at a local bar. And they were interviewing them. And the guys were saying, you see, I wake up in the morning, I go to work, my neighbors are home. I come back in the evening, my neighbors are still home. When will they get, what do they do?
And, you know, and there are other issues, you know, which the media is trying to hide facts. I was just looking at the internet today. They say Obama is actually, the Obama presidency, the Democrats. The Obama presidency has the high, they called Obama the deporter in chief, you know.
Mm.
The number of people who have been deported during the Obama presidency is one of the highest, higher than even George Bush. So, these people who were trying to say that, you know, if this one comes, there will be deportation and that, it is already happening, you know.
Mm. Okay.
So, those are some of the issues. Because we were mainly focusing what the media was giving and highlighting.
Mm.
Many of these things actually escaped, but people were following.
Okay. And I think one
thing that helped Hillary was this idea of now trying to make the white that they are racist, and she fell for it, including making that remark that
deplorable. Half of Trump supporters.
So I think the guy said, "Look." Please, if you think that it's immigrants who really make this country, please, let's remind you. And
okay.
I think Barack also did not help. He got so desperate, made it personal. He was telling guys at rallies, listen to me. If you don't vote for this Hillary, you're killing my legacy. He was almost taking them like children.
And he was being very honest.
He wanted to salvage his legacy.
Yeah,
because now it can be all of it can be.
You should have known that you don't speak down to people like that.
Gentlemen, our time is out. We need to be getting out of here.
But don't forget the FBI letter.
Yes.
No, it really affected Hillary. For anyone with a sense of fairness.
Which gives me the... Maybe their security knew that there was something about Hillary which they really... wanted to stop her from taking the presidency.
That's true, because maybe there's something. Yes, because what it was is the case, they had weighed all these things the six day before the election, but you see the things that, now there's this question, the damned if you do, damned if you don't. If you say nothing about Clinton's email, what if she wins and then she's going to be impeached, she begins her term being impeached, and then they say you held back the information to support her. If you say it now, they'll accuse you of attempting to tilt the election toward Trump. But usually, because of all these Edward Snowden revelations, the whistleblowers, WikiLeaks and whatnot, and this whole question of Watergate, the better crime in America today is to speak more than hold back. Yes. So it is a case of where the die is cast, better to speak and your...
So the die is damaged enough.
Gentlemen, our time is out. We need to get out of here. There is an interesting... this is called the first exclusive interview since the February poll. And he says, it was my detention that was treasonous. Dr. Kizza Besigye is accusing President Museveni of being the one committing treason. And there is, I think it's about 2 pages? Yes, 2 pages of a Q&A. The longest interview is given, exclusive interview is given, which is in the East African newspaper. People can pick up their copies.
But yes. Charles, history will also check that first exclusive interview since February, because now we are really monitoring the media. I don't know if it's the first one, it's because I've seen very many. Now we are monitoring the media.
But I think this guy does a good job of the interview. For people, especially beyond Ugandans who have been following the goings-on with Besigye, he was in Uganda today, and quite a lot of ecstatic crowds there.
Who won?
On the American election, yes, he insists he won the election. On the American elections, I think, yes, the FBI letter was critical. I think Hillary should have hit back. The moment she was cleared, she should have tried to ride on that a little bit more. I think they took a few things for granted, and we haven't had opportunity to explain how the Electoral College versus the popular vote works for our viewers. And I said on Friday on the KFM hot seat that I think Trump will build the wall. I have had second thoughts. There are certain things that might happen. 4 years is not too long.
No.
It's a long time, but also very short.
But no, they were saying on BBC today that actually there is a war.
There is a war.
So it's not as crazy as it sounds. And then I think when it comes to who's going to pay for that, as I think one of the producers of KFM, Joseph Biango, was saying on Friday, it's simple. Just step up the visa requirements.
Yes.
The visa will pay for it.
Actually, America has built so many walls. When they deny you a visa here, you actually pay.
No, there is a physical wall between the United States and Mexico that exists today.
No, and people that wall will be one of the greatest tourist attractions.
Our time is out. We need to get out of here. Thank you very much, Nicholas Sengova. Yeah. Thank you very much, Timothy Kalegia. And thank you very much, Honor Peter Komole. Thank you very much, most of all, to you all, our viewers, who join us every Sunday night, and to our production crew that stays up late to deliver this show to you. From me,